So today we'll be looking at the topic of prayer. And the first thing one may ask, well, this topic is covered in the Catechism of the Catholic Church, the fourth part, which is a part I recommend highly because it's a good, nice treatise on prayer that covers all the aspects of prayer. What we'll attempt to do in this class is to give us a short summary, just highlighting on my own opinion, are the more interesting aspects of that section on the Catechism on prayer. First off, it would ask, what is prayer? What is Christian prayer? How would we define Christian prayer? The Catechism defines it, taking the words of St. John Damascene, as the raising of the heart and mind to God. St. Teresa of Lisieux would also define it in her own way. She would say, well, that for me, prayer is a surge of the heart. It's a simple look turned toward heaven. It's a cry of recognition and of love, embracing both trial and joy. Well, from this second definition, maybe to give it a very brief summary, I would say, well, that prayer is a dialogue of love with God. It's not just a dialogue, but a dialogue of love. And if we look at the life of Jesus Christ, we find that he prays at the key moments in his life. But not just that he prays in the key moments of his life, he prays frequently. For example, when I talk about the key moments of his life, Jesus prays before his public ministry. Before he starts preaching, he goes 40 days and 40 nights in the desert to fast and pray. Before calling the apostles, we find him in prayer. Before multiplying the loaves of bread, we find him praying, giving thanks to God. In the transfiguration on the mountain, he's in prayer. Before raising Lazarus from the dead, he's in prayer. Before the confession of Peter, in blessing the children. He spends all night in prayer. He's at the end of his life, at the Last Supper, he's in prayer. In the Garden of Olives, on the cross. And like Pope Benedict XVI would point out, that he, citing the letter to the Hebrews, chapter 7, verse 25, where it clearly says, the writer of the letter to the Hebrews says that he lives forever and prays for us. We're in heaven, so he continues to intercede for us. And so for Jesus, prayer wasn't just maybe something I did when I have time, but a prayer was fundamental in his life. You say that his life was a life, the Son of God who became man for us, his life was a constant prayer. And for that reason, we can say clearly that, well, that for a Christian, prayer is as necessary as breathing. Maybe we could, you know, at times when a person goes to the swimming pool, you play this game, you know, it's a dangerous game anyway, one has to be careful. That one puts his head underwater and sees how long he can hold his breath. But there's always a limit, because at some point one has to raise his head. If the person keeps it for too long, the person will die, will drown. And the same way too, for a Christian, analogously, just like the person needs air to stay alive, needs to respire, to breathe, to be alive, physiologically speaking, for a Christian, prayer is necessary. If not, it may last for some time, it may last for quite a while, depending on his reserves, his oxygen reserves, you could say, or prayer reserves. But without prayer, a Christian is dead. For a Christian, prayer is as necessary as breathing. The next thing we'll look at now is, well, the content of prayer. When we pray, when we have this dialogue of love with God, what makes up that content of prayer? The Catechism, again, tells us very clearly that there are three, the content of prayer consists of three things. Prayer of adoration, prayer of petition, and prayer of thanksgiving. These three things make up the content of that dialogue of love that we have with God. And the first, that adoration, what does that adoration consist in? It consists basically to honor and praise God and to proclaim his majesty. Many of the Eucharistic prayers, many of the liturgical prayers, many also prayers that people say in public prayers always start with this aspect, you know, we adore God, and to adore God three times holy, to honor and praise and to proclaim his majesty. The second ambit, petition, which you say is the one that is more common. Most of people think of prayer, what you're actually thinking about is to ask God for things, to make petition. But what do we ask God for? We ask God for pardon for our sins. We ask God for graces. We ask God for the needs of others. it's good to remember that, no, that we ask God for pardon for our sins. Also, we say that's a prayer of a petition for God's mercy. If we're asking God for something, then we ask God for his graces, and we ask God for the needs of others, not just our own needs. Then finally, we have the prayer of thanksgiving. Thanksgiving to God, having received what we have. I'm also giving thanks to God for the things that we're not aware of that we have received. And but in general, we say that it's good to give thanks to God always, you know, because everything good we have received comes from God. Remember those words of St. Paul in the letter to the Corinthians. We say, well, what have you that you did not receive? If then you received it, why do you boast as if it were not a gift? And so that always, that the Christian has, well, you see, has find a reason to give thanks to God for everything, because everything comes from God and everything is good. That is the content of prayer: adoration, petition, and thanksgiving. Now, regarding the forms, what we call the forms of prayer, I'd like to have an issue that there are ways or forms of prayer, or we could call them parts of prayer. How, in what way, what manner, what form do people pray? There are as many forms of prayer as there are people on earth. No two people pray the same, because each person has the dialogue with God is unique, irrepeatable. Each person prays and has a relationship with God that is unique. But all the forms of prayer have one basic trait. And this, again, Catechism points it out, that we say that all forms of prayer have for that composure of heart. That composure of heart means that, well, that each person, in order to have a dialogue with God, that one, not just to speak, because we can speak, but that composure of heart, you say that certain recollection, and they use the heart to point out, because that heart is the whole, represents the whole person. It's not just that my brain or my intellect has a conversation with God, or that my will, I say, okay, I'm going to do this and that. No, but that the whole person prays with my intellect, with my will, with my emotion, and that composure of heart necessary in order to have a true dialogue with God. But we could group the forms, ways or forms of prayer into three aspects, you know, and what we call three broad aspects, because each of them are broad, and as you will see, as I described them, how broad they are. There's vocal prayer, there's meditative prayer, and there's contemplative prayer. What do we mean by vocal prayer? Vocal prayer refers to, well, having set, when you say a prayer is vocal, it's set words. That's what vocal prayer is, no? A clear words. For example, the Our Father, the prayer that Jesus taught the apostles, has set words. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come. Or the prayer, glory be to the Father, glory be to the Father, to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, has set words. Or the Hail Mary, or the other prayers that are said, for example, in the Mass, many of them are set words, clearly defined words. Or maybe with the prayer the person says in confession, or the morning prayer that the person says, you know, the morning offering, or the night prayer, or the rosary, they're all set prayers. They're all set with set words, clearly defined words. For many people, for most people, vocal prayer is the first form of prayer that people learn. And the first steps, the first step for many. People don't start with other types of prayer, which I will explain in this class. People start with prayers maybe they learn from their parents, from school, particularly from their mothers, or from a guardian. And short prayers, that short phrases or sentences, or maybe a quote from the Bible, no? You know, for example, Lord, that I may see, Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. Short phrases are set words, and they are the first step for many. But no matter what the vocal prayer is, it's very important that behind it, there's this idea that largely, I think it's from the Middle Ages, I think it's from St. Benedict, where he would say, mens concordet voce, which in Latin means, it's good to put in Latin so to give it more gravity, that the mind should be in concord or in accord with what the voice or what the mouth says. Not just enough for a person to go rattling the words, you know, maybe their father. I say their father, our father who has to them, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come. But my mind is somewhere else. And so that as much as possible, it's true that our mind runs wild very easily, you know, and maybe it's difficult to focus one minute on each of the words. But as much as possible, that when we say any vocal prayer, it's important that we try to make sure that our mind is in accord that with what we are saying, that our mind is there. Saint Teresa of Avila stresses this fact of this man's concordant virtue, that the mind being accord with the voice, by saying that when we pray, that we should consider who we are talking to. Consider that I am the one talking. I am a child of God. I am in need, whatever. Consider who is talking. Consider whom you are talking to. Consider what I'm talking to God. And then she finally says, consider what you are saying. So that we don't just repeat the words without meaning them. So it's a good reminder, whatever vocal prayer, consider who, consider to whom, and consider what is being said. Then, the second form of prayer is meditative prayer. And what's meditative prayer? That meditative prayer is one that is more discursive. Now, we've left the ambit of using set words. Is that prayer that in which one applies one's mind to a topic or to an idea or maybe to a quote, which may come up, maybe a text from the gospel, a text, a quote that we like a lot, and then a person now tries to work to meditate, which is to reflect on it. And so it's more discursive and more reflective, in which one tries to draw a deeper meaning from what is said in that text or that topic or that idea, and relate and talk to God about it. And it's important, the difference between meditative prayer and just personal reflection is that personal reflection, I am thinking to myself. Whereas meditation or meditative prayer, I'm talking to God about this idea, about this topic, about this quote, and applying it, trying to apply it to my life. But I am trying to have a dialogue. Not meditative prayer. It's more discursive and reflective. Then there's contemplative prayer. Contemplative prayer, as the name implies, is to contemplate. What is it to contemplate? That's contemplation goes beyond words. When a person contemplates the sun that is setting, maybe he may say something, we say, wow, how beautiful this sunset is. But it goes beyond words. He stares. He is a gaze, is a gaze of love. And the gaze of love that uses both the intellect, the will, and one's emotions or feelings at the same time. Sometimes people have wanted to classify prayer and say, well, you know, that you start with as children, we start with vocal prayers, and as you get older, you graduate, so to say, to meditative prayer. And then the highest level is contemplative prayer. The experts in prayer, they contemplate. They don't need words again to talk to God because they have that special connection with God. They look at them and look at them. I think it's a very facile classification because it's not exactly true. Sometimes even the great mystics use vocal prayer. They say the rosary, they say the Our Father, trying to mean the words that what they are saying. And also, even people who are just starting off in the way of prayer, contemplate. Everybody knows how to contemplate. I'll give you a typical example. When a mother has a child, and a newborn child typically, and she's carrying the child, and she's looking at the child deeply, she's contemplating. She doesn't say anything. But it's a look of love. And it's a deep look of love, and looking at that, and she contemplates her child. And she uses her intellect, her will, all her emotion. When two lovers look at each other, at times they don't say any words. And that's the gaze of love. And for a Christian too, at times the person may start tabernacle, the person may be before Jesus Christ in the sacrament, and he can also put that gaze of love using his intellect, his will, and his feeling. Now, one question someone may ask is, you know, at times, maybe some of you may have heard of this expression, the mental prayer. What happens in the mental prayer? In the mental prayer, not just meditative prayer. Mental prayer, at that time, maybe a person sets aside each day to spend some time with God, to talk to God about, well, the day. And during that time of mental prayer, the idea is not to go from vocal prayer, maybe when I start off, and then later meditative prayer, and then later contemplative prayer. Anytime the mental prayer, the three forms of prayer happen, in a unique way, that is, as I said earlier on, unique for each person. Maybe sometimes we may start, typically a person starts the mental prayer with an introductory prayer. My Lord and my God, I firmly believe that you are here. It's a vocal prayer. And maybe those words help that person, it's enough for a person to apply my mind to what I just said, and then maybe go deeper in it and I start meditating. Maybe at some point in mental prayer, I've talked to God about, reflected about certain things, and well, I'm just staring. But not just staring blankly, but staring intently, well, putting one's heart, remember what he said, that composure of heart, first of all, as the first step, in order to put one's heart there before God, with one's intellect, with one's will, with one's feelings, well, with one's being, and that contemplation. And then maybe later on, you realize that, well, feeling tired, so you are not really focusing. And then he goes back to make another text that helps him to apply his mind again, or repeats a particular part of a vocal prayer. And then that way, that vehicle of prayer continues throughout the time of that mental prayer till the time the person has allotted for his finishes. And then that vocal, meditative, and contemplative prayer. The three are three general forms, but the three also can happen at the same time during a time of prayer that one has set aside to talk to God. What are the conditions for prayer? In order to pray, I'll mention 8 conditions. They're all interconnected, not as if each of them is really independent. But the first one is that recollection of, say that's already said, that's composure of heart. Recollection means a certain, well, withdrawing oneself. But not just a recollection, looking for a quiet place, silence. Because a person can be go to a quiet place, but maybe inside is a lot of noise. And that noise doesn't allow that person to focus. So it's not just external recollection. There has to be also a certain internal recollection and that a person tries to foster. It's true that maybe in our days now, there's a lot of noise. Let's put it that way. A lot of time listening to music or getting distracted or getting a lot of input, and then but a person has to make that conscious effort, not say, well, for me to be able to pray, I need to set myself apart. There's this in the Gospels, there's this scene in the Gospels, I think John chapter 4, which is very beautiful. Now, when the Samaritan woman goes to the well to pray, goes to the well to fetch water. But I said prayer, it wasn't exactly a mistake, it was a slip of tongue. No, she goes there to fetch water, but she ends up praying. She ends up having a dialogue with Jesus Christ. She goes, she's apart. And it's only when she's apart from the people in the village, only when she goes to that well in the middle of the day, she meets Jesus there waiting for her. Jesus has been waiting for her. And it's a very nice analogy to show, well, that recollection, going apart is necessary. In order to have a deep and long conversation with Jesus Christ, a deep one, not just a superficial one. But that scene in the Gospel also points out something else about that recollection. To know that when I try to set myself apart, when I find a quiet place in the church, that God is waiting for me. It's not that I'm going to meet God. No, God, like Jesus Christ, waited for the woman at the well, is waiting for me. The second condition for prayer is trust. Sometimes we have conversation with people and then we don't trust what the person is going to say, and so we begin to bargain and then we don't take the person's word for, don't give it much value. But it's important to trust in this conversation with God and to trust that at times we ask for things that will not get them, but to trust. The third condition for prayer is perseverance. Not enough that a person maybe talks once, twice, and then maybe till the next following year. That's at times also, there are difficulties in prayer. And maybe another scene from the Gospel that is very beautiful and explains this scene of perseverance very well is Bartimaeus. The scene of Bartimaeus, the blind beggar on the street, who, hearing Jesus passing by, called out, "Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me." And the people told him to keep quiet. But what did he do? He didn't keep quiet, he persevered. He kept on shouting, "Jesus, have mercy on me." And because Jesus heard him, and because he persevered, Jesus came and asked him, "What do you want?" And then said, I want to see. And he restored his sight. Only if one perseveres. There are also many parables on prayer that pointed out that perseverance. The woman who goes to meet the judge and then asks for her rights, you know, the judge that neither fear God nor man. Only because she perseveres, she gets what she wants. Perseverance is very key for prayer. Then there's that condition of humility. We don't go to God with airs, saying, well, going and boasting, no? But humbly, and that humility, like that parable of the Samaritan, sorry, not the Samaritan, the Republican and the poor and the Pharisee goes and to God with air, saying, I've done this and this and that. Whereas the publican simply, with all humility, beats his chest and says, Jesus, and says, God, have mercy on me, a sinner. And he's the one that is answered. Humility, very key to prayer. Then there's simplicity. That simplicity, I would say, is linked to being filial, praying as children, which we'll see later on. But that simplicity, without being complicated. You know, sometimes when people want A and they say C, and then you expect to decipher that actually they're trying to say A. But simplicity, we ask for what we want, we are as we are, without big words, without complexities, but as simple children. Then prayer, is always Trinitarian. Trinitarian, and maybe we see it more in the prayers in the Mass, when we ask through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns in the unity of the Holy Spirit. We ask God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever. And so that each time we're not just dealing with one person of the Blessed Trinity, and that prayer deals with the three. We ask God the Father, through God the Son, with the help inspired, you could say, by God the Holy Spirit. Then we pray as children, is filial. It's not as equal. No? You could say it's like the bedrock of all the things, almost all the things we've seen, no? That only that one has to trust as a child, one has to persevere like a child, one has to be as humble as a child, one has to be simple as a child. And that child that knows, that doesn't put on airs, no? And that knows that he's talking to his father. And that's why it's telling that the prayer that Jesus teaches us is our Father. Then, finally, because that prayer is filial, that prayer should accept God's will. It's not to say to because one goes to pray, as we'll see later in this class. One goes to pray, not seeking my own will, but God's will, and to identify myself at the end of the day. That Christian prayer aims to identify one's will with God's will. Now, we'll look at the only prayer that Jesus Christ taught us, the Our Father. And the Our Father has a certain structure, which you know, we'll see in a subsequent video, but I'll just point out here, first of all, here now. Most of you know the Our Father, but I'll put the part here. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. And then we end with the Amen. Now, I've used different colors here to indicate the different parts of the Our Father. We start with Our Father who art in heaven, addressing God and addressing Him as children, Our Father. And then the next, there are seven petitions in the Our Father, as you can see. The first three have to do, say, directly with God. And then the next four, from give us this day to but deliver us from evil, have to do with our own needs. And is that most perfect structure, which the next video we're going to see now explains these seven petitions very well.
What is the Our Father? The Our Father is the first and principal prayer of the church. Jesus himself taught it to his disciples. As a prayer, it is revolutionary because God isn't addressed as a distant, ineffable being, the Almighty, to whom we bow down in fear and trembling. But instead we call him our loving Father. He accepts. Accepts me as his child, and not just me, but all who call upon him. That's why we pray our Father and not my Father. All of us have a common Father, making us brothers and sisters. The Our Father contains seven requests or petitions. The first petition is, Hallowed be thy name. We live out this petition when we place God above everything, when all that we do is for his greater glory. The second petition is, Thy kingdom come. The kingdom of a ruler is the realm where his words are not only heard, but obeyed. When we ask for the coming of his kingdom, we're not only longing for something future and universal, but we're asking for God, here and now, to take dominion over our hearts. In our hearts, he should already be crowned king and rule. There, in our hearts, his kingdom should already begin. The third petition is, Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. This petition expresses the faith and trust that we should have as children. We may not always understand everything happening here on earth, but we're comforted by the fact that God's will directs everything for the best for his children. The fourth petition is, Give us this day our daily bread. In this petition, we turn to God, the source of everything. We ask for the things that we need to live, and asking God may help us discern what's really necessary. The fifth petition is, Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. If God forgives us, then we also have to forgive one another. Communion with God the Father isn't possible if we, as children, refuse to be reconciled to each other. The sixth petition is, Lead us not into temptation. In this petition, we are imploring God to stand by us in trials, temptations, and difficult times. The seventh petition is, Deliver us from evil. We ask God that he may destroy the power of evil in our lives, so that we live no longer as children of darkness, but as children of light. These are the seven petitions of the Our Father. We end it as we do with all prayers with an Amen. Amen is an ancient Hebrew word that means, so be it. With this word, we confirm the seven petitions that we have offered as children to our Heavenly Father.
So, now this final section, we'll be looking at four, what I call them, FAQs, frequently asked questions on prayer. I just chose this for arbitrary because I've been asked this question several times, and I think it was good to end with so that this class is not just a theoretical class, considering the topic we are considering. The first one is, well, why pray if God already knows what I need? Why pray? The second, what to do before difficulties in prayer? And then thirdly, why are some prayers not answered? And then finally, you know, we've been talking about the prayer in dialogue, but well, really, how does God speak to man in prayer? Does he come out, I don't know, does he appear an angel to speak to man? So we'll take these questions in turn. First question, why pray if God already knows what I need? And maybe to answer that question is the catechism, what we've already seen in part pointed out, even though the catechism dwells a bit more on it, well, that the content of my prayer is not just limited to petition. We've already said that the prayer consists of three parts. There's prayer of petition, there's prayer of adoration, first of all, and there's prayer of thanksgiving. So that when we say, I pray if God already knows what I need, yes, he knows, but he wants us to ask. He wants us to ask. Because above all, our prayer is about building a relationship with God, with another. It's not just about asking for things. And our prayer, because we have friends, Imagine if you have a friend that all that you do is asking for things, and of course the person will just run away from you. So when he sees you coming, he will run away. No, but our friends, we ask for things, but we also do things. We also offer favors for our friends, and that's what builds our friendship. So you see, what above all, that friendship is built by what someone called a common activity. The friends that we have, our close friends, something that we did together, they help to develop that friendship, that common activity. And for the Christian, to become friends with God, that common activity is prayer. And so God wants us to ask. God, he knows what he wants us to ask in order to build that relationship with God. The second question, what to do before difficulties? This is a classic, no? And I'll just mention four typical difficulties that come up in prayer. Well, at times people feel that prayer is a waste of time, and that I could be doing other things in this time. I have assignments, I have work, I have this other issue, and so on and so forth. Sometimes it's distraction. The person goes to pray, and then one gets distracted easily, and we start wondering, well, this composure of heart, what am I doing here? Thirdly, dryness, and then fourthly, lack of faith. But very quickly, so that we don't, because this would say so many things about them, but to say that prayer is a waste of time is a temptation of the devil, who uses that material that is not limits man's dealings to what is productive, what is valuable, but that's not the case. There are several things that we do that a person needs to rest, and we say, well, is rest productive? But if we go back to the beginning, what we started with, you know, that prayer is to build a relationship with God. And so that if I want to make friends with someone, I have to waste time with the person, so to say. Yeah, so not a bad thing to waste time. If you don't waste time with your friends, you will not have any friends. So that temptation of the devil to say prayer is a waste of time. Yes, it's a temptation of the devil. But also to realize that, well, if I don't waste time with my friends, I have no friends. Yeah, so that's waste time. But waste time, I'm not saying all the time, but sometimes a person under pressure. But to realize that, well, look, if I don't spend time, I have no friends. The second one with distractions. Distractions can come in different forms. But one thing the catechism points out very clearly is that distractions reveal what one is attached to. If a person goes to prayer and every time a particular song is playing in his head, a particular movie is playing in his head, then they sign that, well, maybe perhaps you like this song too much, or this movie too much, and that you are a bit attached to it. Sometimes maybe worries, and then it's good. The catechism also points out, say that we should run away from, don't try to fight the distraction, we should run away from the distraction. We should avoid them. Foster that composure of heart. But it's true that maybe sometimes worries may come, and rather than, and maybe they're difficult to run away from because they're worrying us, rather than letting them worry us, to try to distract us from, distract one from praying, to convert those distractions, if they are noble, into prayer, to let them form part of that conversation with God. So I don't know, I'm worried about this test that I did and I did badly in it, or I'm worried about this appraisal at the office, whether I will get this promotion or whether I'm going to be sacked. Well, maybe, yes, reveals that maybe I'm attached to it, I'm worried about it. Try to convert that into prayer. And that means not to start thinking about it, but to abandon it in God's hands. There's this story that attributed to Saint Benedict, who lived in the 11th century, that one day he went horse riding with a friend of his, and his friend now said, well, you know, I never get distracted when I pray. And then Saint Benedict said, well, I always get distracted when I pray, but I try to turn it to prayer or to push it aside so that I can, when I realize, focus on God. And then he had it. And then they had a wager, which he said, well, if you can say the Our Father without any distraction, I will give you my horse. So the friend started, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. And when he got to give us his day, he paused and said, well, are you going to give me also the bridle of the horse? And then, well, Benedict pointed out to him, well, you just got distracted. The issue is not getting distracted or not. The issue is, well, what do we do when we realize we're distracted? If the person comes back to prayer, then no problem. But not to give in to distractions. Just try to run away from them as much as possible to minimize them. But a prayer with many distractions, if they struggle, is still very good prayer. Then there's the difficulty is dryness. At times, dryness may come can be a trial that God permits for a while. The person goes and then I don't know what to say. I'm just blank for a while. Even the saints, many saints have had the dryness for a while praying. And it's a trial from God so that they're not seeking themselves. Because, you know, if I go each time I go to prayer and I get, I don't know, some spiritual vitamins and I'm very energized, then maybe I'm doing it, at times I'm doing it because I'm seeking myself. And I want, I'm seeking what my own personal benefits. You know. At times God may permit that dryness so that one deepens in one's love for God. That trial that helps that person to purify the reason why he wants that relationship with God. Also, dryness may happen in a case, I didn't put it in the slide, but it's good to note, when a person, God is asking the person for something, it's clear, and but the person is not, doesn't want to carry it out. And so that dryness is, we say, self-inflicted because the person doesn't want to talk about it. Like, you know, maybe a husband and wife have an issue and we don't talk about it. And I talk about other things and this and that, maybe two friends. But there's a certain coldness between them because it's an issue that is central that they don't want to address. Same thing in one relationship with God, the person may be avoiding a certain issue that maybe I need to change, I need to be more committed. And so my prayer will be dry because, in a sense, this person has asked me to do something, has pointed out something to me, and I'm just ignoring it. Then the last difficulty that the Catechism points out is a lack of faith. That a person says, well, I don't know if I like praying, and then lack faith. And maybe that scene in the gospel where the father goes to meet Jesus to cure his son who is epileptic, and he says, well, Lord, I believe, help my unbelief. And that also demands, well, that time is a prayer, a beautiful prayer is to ask God for a greater faith in him. But all these difficulties, the Catechism points out very nicely, call for a humble vigilance of heart. Not just a vigilance of heart. Vigilance of heart meaning that heart that seeks, that is vigilant, that that perseveres for love's sake. But it's not just one that perseveres for love's sake, but one that is humble. That doesn't think that, well, I can take all the distractions myself, I can deal with dryness myself, or I can create my own faith. That humbly asks for help. The next thing that we'll look at now is the third one. Why are some prayers not answered? And the Catechism is a very, you say for me, a bit of a sarcastic answer to that. It starts by pointing out that that people when they talk about prayers not being answered and they complain that my prayer is not answered, that they are talking about one type of prayer, not all types of prayer. And that's the prayer of petition. I'll read what it says because I find it very amazing. It says, in the first place, we ought to be surprised by the fact that when we praise God or give him thanks for his benefits in general, we are not concerned whether or not our prayer is acceptable to him. When we adore God, we prepare our adoration and prayer of thanksgiving. We don't start asking, did God hear my prayer? Did God answer my prayer? We don't ask about that. We're not concerned about that. On the other hand, we demand to see the results of our petitions. What is the image of God that motivates our prayer? An instrument to be used or the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ? And what's the image of God? Am I going there to use God? Or I'm going there to ask a friend? And also leaving that friend space to act. Later on, the Catechism, of course, dwelling on that. But I mean, it's not maybe sounds sarcastic, but at times maybe we really need something, maybe an admission or a relative that is there to be healed. And we're wondering, well, why God not answering that? I'll come to that. But maybe at times we get any smaller things, not to ask God for you, give me this. And then the problem is that the prayer is now centered on the gift and not the giver. Rather, our prayer should be centered on the giver, not the gift. And if we have the giver, we have all the gifts that we need. However, prayer may not be answered because of three things, and this is from St. Augustine. He says that, well, that sometimes he gives three reasons. He says, one, that maybe what we're asking for is not good for us in the long run. It may not be obvious to us now, like a child that asks for a knife, maybe 2-year-old, 3-year-old child, because he saw it on television, asks father for a knife or for matches. No. Father knows, look, this thing is not good for this child. It may injure him, so he doesn't grant it. Second reason he says that at times because we live wrongly. And that happens to also with parents, with their children. The child is asking for something, but the father knows, has asked the child to take care of a particular, maybe to clean up his room, to finish his assignment, take care of this child. He's asking for things. But the father said, look, I'm not giving you this until you do what I ask you to do. So that we live wrongly. And so when one is praying, that one needs to consider if I... So I have to find out if, well, there's something to examine one's conscience and say, well, is there something in my lifestyle that needs to be changed, though, to be improved? Though? And then thirdly, he says that there are times we ask wrongly. We ask with little faith. And so that when one examines, when one prays, also is good to ask, really, am I praying with faith? Or I'm just ask, but I'm not really putting my mind there. I don't want to be disappointed, so let me not really put my mind there. To pray with faith, to ask our Lord with faith, to ask God with faith, to ask like a child who asks for the moon. Then, fourthly, the last question, so as not to make this class excessively long. At the end of the class, there will be a nice video for those who endure to the end. Behind all this, we've been saying, well, prayer is a dialogue, but how does God speak to man in prayer? What do you hear God's voice? The truth is that many times before we go to pray, God already speaks to us. Of course, he speaks to us. He has that power to speak to us. In our prayer, and then you feel an interior motion of the soul. You know, an idea strikes you. It's God that is speaking. If you feel a presence, sometimes yes, and maybe. But the danger in that is always looking for that presence every time. Sometimes you don't really feel anything. It's as if prayer is very difficult. But also to know that even before the time of prayer, God speaks to us. And whether he speaks to us, I put that in red to highlight it. He speaks to us in several means, you know, not just because he's so powerful, he can speak through several means, through the circumstances of our day, through the advice that we receive, through the comments from a friend, and at times even through comments from enemies. He speaks to us. He speaks to us through the things that struck us. Maybe from a text in the Bible that maybe you open and it strikes you, or a sermon, and maybe there's a part of that sermon or a meditation that strikes you, but doesn't strike the other people, and you feel as if, well, God is talking to me. Sometimes it's something that you read in a book and that strikes you. Or what I said earlier on, an interior motion in one's heart. It may happen at the time of prayer or may happen somewhere else. But all those things, God is speaking. And therefore, in the sense that prayer is learning to listen to God talk. To learn to listen to God talk. That's what prayer really is, man. To what God has been trying to tell me during the day. And that's why, as you said earlier on, that it requires that recollection of heart, that interior silence. Because that's the only place where we can hear and we can really listen to what God has been trying to tell us through the things, through the circumstances of our day, the advice, the comments, the things that struck us, something that we read, to put all that together. And then say, well, what's God trying to tell me through this? All of that requires faith. That faith is something that we say, even though it's, if one doesn't go to pray, one doesn't have faith. If one does not advance in prayer, if one, and praying also helps increase that faith, to put it that way. But that one has to go, knowing that, well, that nothing happens to me by chance. And that God speaks through many ways to me. And so I want to go to listen and also to talk to him in return. I'll just end here. As I said, the reward for those who have endured to him. It's a song that I like a lot by a singer called Sam Smith, where he talks about, the title of the song is Pray. And there he speaks about and you listen to the lyrics of a man who realized at the end of the day that everybody prays in the end. Everybody needs to pray. And so with this, we end this class.
I'm young and a fool. I made bad decisions. I block out the news. Turn my back on religion. Don't have no degree. I'm someone naive. I've made it this far on my own. But lately that thing been getting me high. I lift up my head and the world is on fire. There's dread in my heart and fear in my bones. And I just don't know what to say. Maybe I'll pray. I have never believed in you more, but I'm gonna pray. Make some noise. You won't find me in church or reading the Bible. I am still here and I'm still your disciple. I'm down on my knees, I'm begging you please. I'm broken, alone and afraid. I'm not a saint, I'm more of a sinner. I don't want to lose, but I feel for the winners. And when I try to explain, the words run away. That's why I'm stood here today. And I'm gonna pray. Won't you come in? Can we have a one-on-one business? Talk about freedom.